Great, perfect. Come on in, have a seat. Thank you, everybody. On behalf of my colleagues in the Center for Civil and Human Rights and Notre Dame Law School, I'm pleased to welcome all of you, and especially Pokua, Mama Pokua. There she is. I welcome you to Engaging South African Constitutional Justice, what we think will be an extraordinary conversation with what we know to be an extraordinary group of lawyers, of alumni of Notre Dame, from the master's and doctoral programs in international human rights law. These programs were founded in the late 1980s and owe their existence, as do many of the university's programs that seek to advance equality, peace, human rights through education. They owe this to the vision of Father Ted Hesburgh. We've spent the last hour and a half, maybe 2 hours, driving around campus in a golf cart. You've seen these golf carts, and I've rolled my eyes at them in the past. But today we were those people, and we were driving around in a golf cart and visiting iconic sites, telling stories, retelling origin stories as we know them about our program, about different points on campus. And I think some of those origin stories might have even been true. We tell stories about the founding of our human rights program here in the law school as well. And the story that I've received and the story that I tell is that early in the 1980s, when Father Ted Hesburgh was in South Africa, he met with one of his friends, Judge Richard Goldstone. Judge Goldstone was one of the few federal judges who was using his position in the federal judiciary to attack apartheid from the inside. When Father Ted asked Judge Goldstone what he could do to assist him in his efforts, Judge Goldstone replied, "Educate our lawyers." And with that simple sentence, with that simple request, the LL.M program and the doctoral program in human rights were born. The lawyers you see seated in front of you today are the fruits of that conversation. They are among the more than 36 South African lawyers who have graduated from the human rights degree programs at Notre Dame Law School. But these are the trailblazers. They blazed the now well-worn trail between South Africa and Notre Dame, a trail that, as we learned this morning in discussing with students who have studied, who have researched, done different types of engagement in South Africa, a trail that goes both ways, not just South Africa to Notre Dame, but Notre Dame to South Africa. They are the trailblazers. In 1987, a young South African, were you young at the time? I'm assuming you were young at the time. Yeah. A young lawyer named Vino Jaichand became the first participant in the newly created LLM program. He had previously done graduate work at University of Miami and then came to Notre Dame in 1987, an interesting time to wear both a University of Miami cap and a Notre Dame cap. Soon after, Mbuiseli Madlanga came to Notre Dame and completed his LLM degree in 1990. While living here in the seminary on campus. I'll let him tell you that story himself. Mbuiseli returns to his alma mater as justice of one of the most important and most cited tribunals in the world, the Constitutional Court of South Africa. And Justice Madlanga will be delivering a lecture this evening, the Klein's lecture at 5:30 in this very room. And we invite you all back to be participants in that occasion as well. Vinod returns as the Dean of the University of Witwatersrand, one of the most important law schools, and I say the most important law school in South Africa. In 1995, Judith Cohen and Jackie Cassette arrived together on campus. Jackie had been a professor at Vitz Law School and then worked after graduation, after completing her degree from Notre Dame, at the ICTR and the ICTY in The Hague with Judge Goldstone, who was the prosecutor of those bodies. And then she returned to South Africa and clerked for him at the nascent constitutional court in South Africa. Judith returned to her work at NGO Lawyers for Human Rights, working on farm worker eviction cases. And she's been a senior lawyer at the National Human Rights Institution in South Africa since 2001, most recently doing work related to the coordinating body of all national human rights institutions and their interaction with the Human Rights Council in Geneva. But these are their stories to tell, and to help them do that, we'll turn to Professor Christine Venter, the director of the legal writing program here in the law school. Christine did her BA and her LLB in South Africa at the University of Cape Town, and that was prior to her becoming a double domer, and V-Node's a double domer. It's easy to be generous in recognizing double domers when you're a triple domer. Yeah. So, without further ado, Professor Venter, if you would take the floor and help tease some of these stories out of our guests who are here really for the first time all together in over 20 years. So this is a very exciting occasion for us. Professor Venter.
Well, thank you so much, Sean, and thank you for letting me do this, because it's such a personal and professional honor for me to sit at a table with these dear friends and colleagues. And because time is short, I'm going to start with Professor Jaichand, who will tell you his own fabulous story. But I just want to note, although he's the dean of Vitz Law School, there is not universal agreement at this table that that is, in fact, the best law school. In fact, I personally take issue with that. So what Sean alluded to earlier was Father Hesburgh created this program to educate lawyers in human rights. And he obviously had this vision that somehow that would help in the transformation of South Africa, that that would help sow the seeds of a human rights culture. And many of the people sitting at this table have wonderful stories about how they came to pursue their passion for human rights. But I just wonder, if Vinada, if we could start with you, because you were the first LL.M here, and in fact, you were the LL.M. How your background and personal story intersected with Notre Dame, and how you've taken the seeds of human rights education and returned to South Africa to sow those. So.
Thank you very much, Christine. That's a difficult question to answer.
Many ways. But shortly after I'd finished the master's degree here, Dean Link and Provost O'Meara joined me in South Africa, because part of the condition of the Bradwell Foundation scholarship was to give a public lecture. And I had to give it in two venues. One was in Stellenbosch, which was the home of all South African white presidents. And I was talking on the black right to vote in 1988, which was daunting in its own way, except when you do it in Stellenbosch and you happen to be the only dark face around. Then, subsequent to that, I had to give a talk at the University of Witwatersrand, probably in the law school. It is also far too vague now to recall where it was. But those two events themselves had launched my academic career. And they had actually introduced me to the academia in South Africa in very many ways. But the fact that those two senior people from Notre Dame joined me on that particular trip was fundamentally important for where I had to begin my own exercise. Rights activist, lawyer. I'm still trying to define what I do completely. These days, I mentioned to Barbara Fick that I am a bureaucrat, a bean counter. I work out what's the research numbers and whether, you know, the rands that we spent are valuable. But my whole trajectory has been essentially around education and legal education, and with a short spell at Lawyers for Human Rights, which I headed for 5 years in company with my colleagues here. I found for the first time a chance to be at the coalface of what was happening in human rights. So there was all the theoretical knowledge, able to translate that sometimes in the classroom, But you had to test the validity of some of those norms that we have in a very beautiful constitution and in a very progressive court. And tomorrow I'll talk a little bit more about this, but one of my levels of disillusionment has been around, even with the best types of laws, not likely to always have the kind of outcome you're looking for. Because we leave too much of a weight on courts to sort this out for us. So that was the journey towards Lawyers for Human Rights. But subsequent, after that, I went and joined the Irish Center for Human Rights in Galway, Ireland, because I thought, what's the point in just being with the fighting Irish? The real Irish might be a bit more fun. And it turned out they were an awful lot of fun. And there we did a lot of international human rights work, mainly teaching master's programs and a number of doctoral students. And at that point, I began to understand what it is to be part of a panel and a group of, let's say, people examining PhDs, when I have Professor Peter Walsh here, who's part of my doctoral panel some 20, 21 years ago. I can only talk about my age. But the joy of seeing what you pass on to another student in a doctoral program is a difficult thing to explain to anyone who hasn't supervised or been part of an examination. You give a lot of yourself. You give a great deal of your own ideas melded with the ideas of that particular student. And I think of the last time I was here in 2010, I proclaimed that I was very happy to be a Rhodes Scholar. Not the colonial Rhodes, but a Robert E. Rhodes. And he was sitting in the audience. And a number of us have passed through his hands. He was a remarkable man who stretched you all the time in both your writing and your thinking and whatever else you did. So in very many ways, he would be very much the kind of guru, I could put right up there, someone who had aspired to be like a teacher, like he was. So Notre Dame has been a very integral part of my life as a law teacher. Spent that time in Ireland, returned to Wits to start the International Human Rights Exchange Program with Bard College in upstate New York, sending American students to try and find out what the constitutional adventure in South Africa was all. And then shortly after that, I was appointed to become dean at the Wits Law School. But the sum total of all of what you're asking me, where did it begin? What was the idea, and how did it actually develop? And if I try to look back to my own particular career, I'd say it was all just simply following an ideal. And I think that ideal still has to be translated for our country to make the constitutional values become real for the larger majority of people, especially in the socioeconomic rights area. So we have a good court, we have great laws, but we have in between occasionally not too good executives or, let's say, people in the political arena. And so there's a large degree of a fumble, and that's a word that's well understood here in Notre Dame, a fumble between good laws and the kinds of outcomes that you would expect from those laws. So I think the pursuit in legal education for me has been, I think I've always been a teacher. I was a high school teacher before I studied law, and I don't think I've changed. I'm still a teacher, but I learn a great deal more from what I teach days than from what I actually pass on to others. So Notre Dame's been a key part of my whole experience, and the human rights culture that you're talking about, essentially your own ideal aspirations that you hope that the rest of the country catches up with, and it usually doesn't. So there's always a gap in this large degree of disappointment. But there's always tomorrow and another battle to be fought.
I want to ask you one very quick follow-up question, though. So we were talking last night, and I think a lot of our students might think you're an academic, and so you're removed from the rough and tumble of human rights and how those are kind of being played out on the ground. But that is, in fact, not true, because education has become a really contentious issue in South Africa, access to education.
Absolutely correct. It started in Cape Town, which I won't contest as being probably the best law school, where Roads Must Fall was a student movement, and then that followed subsequently at Wits, with Fees Must Fall. So So questions on access to education, cost of education, the culture of, I'm at a historically white university. I'm the first black male dean in 93 years. So there's a lot of lag there in these particular institutions in trying to understand a student population that's more than 80% black. Okay? So there's a great deal of a very large gap between the expectations of the culture of those universities and the backgrounds of the students that actually come up. So the protest movement, in fact, very many say, is the unfinished business of 1976, being the 40th anniversary. So the education of so many young people then was interrupted by Afrikaans. Now they're saying it's being interrupted by the culture of the dominant culture of whiteness. And they're talking about deconstructing the course outlines. They're talking about active engagements in, for example, in my law school, they sit on the executive board. And I consult with them with the next particular step here. They're talking transformation. And for transformation, they mean much more than just a color change of your faculty. They're talking about aligning themselves with the kinds of values that come from our constitution and where they actually sit. So I think students have become, again, militant, activist, and keen to redirect that. The result of that is that you might have seen on television a burning of a few buildings. In the Northwest University, there's been in Cape Town the removal of statues and burning of artworks, all as part of the protest of students saying, we want South Africa to reflect a culture that's akin to ours in many ways. And this has left management of universities completely, because we don't know what the next step is. So we are in reactive mode. It leaves law school management even in another place because law schools are elitist. They are about dealing with a group of people who already have both the means and the ability to become lawyers. And therefore, thereafter, be able to advise their particular community. But there's a big gap now between the lawyer of the age in which the activist lawyer was there to serve a community, and now the lawyer who is there to serve themselves. So Africa is in a bit of a crisis of individuality and the communal old communities, or the communal beliefs and the communal practices. And I think that's playing itself also. I think, quite frankly, that the fees must fall is about, and I'll talk a little bit more about this tomorrow, is about social and economic rights deferred. They ought to have started more than 20 years ago. But I think we haven't been able to embed very many of the socioeconomic rights, although they're protected in our constitution. And I think education is a key part of that. Come back now to the very point at which we had a number of concerns raised about where education was going. And the students of today, including the ones at Wits and elsewhere, are asking the same question, but in different formats to deal with different issues in there.
So I'm going to ask Judith Robb-Cohen to describe now her work on the ground. Vinod's given us the somewhat academic perspective, but Judith has been actively involved in a number of different institutions and organizations and has a variety of perspectives to offer. So I just ask you to tell us about those.
I was reflecting on my time at Notre Dame and how it has prepared me for my. And I have also been reflecting how, in a sense, I feel returning here to Notre Dame, my life has gone full circle, and I'll speak. I want to just start with a story, because that will explain, and I realize it has characterized my. Had I not come here to Notre Dame, I would not have been. And my experience there, I realized in yeah, and I seem to attract what happened at the criminal? I arrived, I got called in an office by this very, lawyer. He smiled. Well, he wrote me off. I was back for an internship. Why don't you just go down the hallway and go join them? You want to, let's get rid of her. I'm out here for a few months. Down to this team, and they weren't particularly interested, but I was sort of left by myself. Okay, something you'll see the pattern. And to do my own thing, and to make up my internship, I wanted. And so I started looking around. Realized that on the team we had analysts, we had Scotland Yard detectives, parents, and all this, I had no one with international humor. No one who understood what the elements of a crime were. And I realized that that's where I. Yet in time. So they landed up just giving me all these witness statements, which I just started reading through. And they started thinking, how? And very soon they found me as they went back into the former unit. Oh, yeah, I would assist in preparing. However, if you want this matter, this is the element of the crime which is not present, and we would need. Affidavit, small affidavit from this person in order that we could then potentially consider whether we could have an affidavit. The other thing I realized was going through all these witness statements was one particular name which kept on coming up, and I was determined that this person I was going to name was a monster. He was evil personified. He had done one of the things I can recall. He had, for example, just opened fire on, I think it was a donkey cart with about 20 on them and killed them in it. As he carried on firing, okay? And the problem was, every time he's in it, was never enough information to nail him, and I was determined, I am going to nail this man before I. And that is how I got involved at the tribunal in looking at issues around sexual violence. I found out, this is another lesson I've learned tonight.
I'm here for you,
want to
go back. Don't realize at the time.
And how I think I landed up nailing this guy is that I worked out that in terms of chain of command, he was responsible.
The most horrific. A captive by soldiers. She was
unspeakable. Manner of ways. I read these women. I read how she wanted to commit.
Throw herself into the river. How these soldiers would come and tea.
And I worked out that
this man was in.
And in this way, I then started working around sexual. Of rape, those of you.
Earlier. They got him, they nailed him, not after I left, but the initial indictment I provided.
So that is the story I wanted to give. It's like, if you really want something, you can go out there and you can get it. And on my return to South Africa, I just constantly with challenges which I never expected. Be it when I was a young lawyer, the justice name, this one. I once had a umkhonto wesizwe, ex-soldier, okay? Those were our freedom fighters. Arrive in my office, okay? And the new South African Defense Force, they were trying to get rid of the Umkhonto soldiers, okay? So they had brought trumped up charges against him. Yeah, he landed up. Could you imagine? Shortly after, in about 96, the new South Africa, for the first time, they allowed outside lawyers, not military lawyers, into a military court martial. Yeah, I was this young woman with an Umkhonto soldier. I got an offer. They didn't know what to do with me, okay? They didn't know what to do with me. But so it continued. Then I went.
Votes for human rights, with farm workers. There was new legislation to protect farm workers against evictions. We had never had this before.
I was told, yeah, Judith, set up this project, go out, make sure that farm workers don't get evicted.
And to do it, before we knew it, we had a few judgments, which until this day are considered as some leading judgments. And then going to the Human Rights Commission, where I've been for 15 years, and just
having the most incredible opportunities, working in all different areas of law,
either through legislation,
public hearings, and every time, it's something that no one else had done before. Writing up a public hearing report and recommendations to government in the area of
farm workers, going to our parliament, sitting there and telling parliamentarians, this is what should be in the law. What you're doing is not right. Being able to draw on my international human rights.
And then in the last 3 to 4 years,
with South Africa heading up the international body of national human rights institutions,
or rights commissions around, working at that international level where frontier in terms of every country have a national human rights institution. They are regarded as a natural partner on the ground in the country by the as a bridge between the international and between the domestic. And that is where the new frontiers in human rights,
as we've seen in the last 2 years, of violence and egregious conflicts that are going on in the world, and how more than ever we need human rights at a global level in this world.
And that we need a at a global level in.
And so who knows what my next boundary or frontier is. Thank you.
But not all of us can have those incredible experiences, obviously. And some of you may be going to big law firms and thinking, well, what has this got to do with me? And she's had multiple experiences in different organizations and different situations advancing human rights, but now she's in
advancing it in a different way. So, Jackie.
I think like Judith said, in so many ways, I think you have an idea, perhaps as a young person, as to life path is and how you'd like to achieve it. And then you take your first step out, and it doesn't always work out the way you'd like. And life has a different plan. And I think it's about running with the opportunities that you're given, and in a way trusting your instincts and just flowing with it. So I started out actually like Renaud as an academic, in fact, teaching public international law at the University of Witwatersrand. And to be honest, largely because I couldn't get articles in a law firm at the time. So this was back in, no, it's true. And this was at the very end of the apartheid era, where I think, and we're a society that I think faces still inequality on many different levels. And gender inequality is still there. We've made strides, but it was something. So I was a young woman interested in human rights, the early 90s, before the end of the apartheid era, and I wasn't useful to. There've been a number of interesting sort of cycles in my life as well. So I started out, and I couldn't get articles in a law firm, and yet I'd graduated in the top 10% class. I tutored. I was a good student. And so I fell into academics because I didn't know what else to do. And actually, at the time, one of my very first mentors, and I think that's also the important Professor John Dugard, who is perhaps one of the most famous international lawyers, he took me under his wing, and he nurtured me, and he asked me to come and teach international law at the Wits Law School. So that was my first job. And I taught, and I had an interest in international law. I taught and human rights law. So I started out a combination of a mix of human rights law. And at the time, of course, it was during the last few years of apartheid. And so human rights was a very kind of it wasn't a mainstream thing. It was kind of a few radical left wing people that did that. And When we thought about human rights, we drew a lot on international law experience, because obviously the genesis of most domestic internet, you know, human rights institutions and cultures actually is from post Second World War UN and you know, international law experience. And then after a few years, I applied for the Bradless Foundation Scholarship, which actually was set up by Goldstone, who I'd never met. And I had no idea at the time that I would land up actually talking to him and meeting him and working with him at the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal at the time. I mean, that would have just been a fantasy if you told me. So, you know, in retrospect, I was angry, and I think I felt angry about not having had an opportunity to corporate law firm, which I'm doing now, but on my own terms, doing really interesting work as the pro bono coordinator. But I'm thankful now, because had I gone to a law firm at that time, I wouldn't have had the kinds of opportunities that I did have. So I landed up, I won the scholarship, and I came to, and it was an incredible privilege to spend a year learning about international human rights, surrounded by colleagues and practitioners and activists from all over the world, people from the Chilean Truth Commission, and at that time, it was the most extraordinary time for us in South Africa. It was 1994, 1995. We literally just had our first democratic elections. Born in, Nelson Mandela was our president. The Constitutional Court delivered its first judgment while we were here. And there was this extraordinary sense of optimism, excitement, and we had our Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which was just set up and starting its work. And, you know, we got this opportunity to learn from the Chileans and the work that they were doing. And so it was an amazing experience. And from there, like Judith, the opportunity to go and do an internship at the, I spent a year there working in the prosecutor's office, and it was a wonderful opportunity to explore national law and the criminal and to meet once again an amazing bunch of people, both domestic lawyers and international lawyers. And it was there, just by chance actually, that I got to do an assignment for Justice Goldstone. And I had actually applied at the time to become a clerk at the Constitutional Court, but because I was here, I was in The Hague, I didn't have an opportunity to, I shortlisted, I didn't have an opportunity to actually go and interview with all of them. And Justice Goldstone needed a clerk. Up all the courage to go and knock on his door and ask him if you know, there was possibly any opportunity or whether another clerk. And he just said to me, "You've got the job." So it was amazing. And from there, yeah. So I also had a wonderful time. Actually, also, it was amazing to spend a year working with him at the tribunal, and then to go back and work. You know, about the international law to court, and then subsequently in my practice. I practiced as a barrister for 12 and a half years before I went into a law firm, mostly constitutional work, and drawing on international law, our constitution, as I'm sure, you know, in terms of the interpretation clause, our judges draw on international, both international law and comparative jurisprudence to carve out, I think, some of the most amazing human rights and constitutional jurisprudence. And after 12 and a half years there, it was time to move on, and now I find myself in a big corporate law firm heading up the pro bono department and pushing the boundaries and the barriers once again. We have an amazing constitution, but the biggest problem, I think, in our society is inequality. And so I think the biggest challenge is making these rights a reality for people, trying to assist them to find opportunities to actually assert their rights. I do now, and it's a great privilege, I think, really, to be doing the work that I enjoy in a big corporate law firm and to be paid. And pushing boundaries. We're pushing many boundaries in South Africa. It'll never end. So thank you. It's wonderful to be back here. It's a great privilege to my colleagues and to reminisce and to realize how much this consequences for us and for the work that we do, and hence the societies, I think, that we're in.
So last and certainly not least, our distinguished visitor, Justice Madlango, who's the Klein Chair and will be delivering his lecture this evening at 5:30, I believe, in this room. But before I get to Justice Madlango, I'd really encourage you, like, these are all just teasers for you to come to the event tomorrow, which is an all-day event, and listen to all these wonderful people talk at greater length, so you can hear more about. But I just want to turn it over to Justice Madlango, who has an incredible story of his own.
Good afternoon to you all. Context of the apartheid era, what is called parliamentary supremacy, meaning that courts cannot question the validity of laws. They just have to enforce them as they are. The only way they can invalidate them is if the procedures set by the Constitution have not been followed. If those procedures have been followed, you just have to follow the law. So in that context, one could not really talk about constitutionalism in South Africa as we understand that concept in constitutional democracies. But that notwithstanding, somehow within me, I just had an interest in human rights. And in a national setting, and especially the university that I went to as a student, which was the University of Transkei, which is unlike Wits, which is unlike UCT, but still one in which I think I got a very good legal education, one could not hope for much. For instance, a professor who took us for constitutional law had been a minister of justice in the so-called homeland of Transkei. Homelands were the backbone of the apartheid system. What Verwoerd did, Verwoerd being the prime minister who introduced apartheid in 1948, but this doesn't mean that the subjugation of black people, the downtrodden manner in which they were treated started in 1948, no. Started with colonialism way back. But the term apartheid as such was introduced by Verwoerd in 1948. And as part of that, and apartheid is actually an Afrikaans word for separateness, apartheid. So what he did was to create these homelands, which were territories meant for all the black African people. if you are a Motswana, it doesn't matter that you are a fourth generation Sowetan in the city of Johannesburg, the economic hub of South Africa. It doesn't matter. If you are a Motswana, I, as Verwoerd, have created a homeland for all the Botswana in Buputatswana. You will now be a citizen of Botswana, and I am taking away, and you have no say in the matter, I'm taking away your citizenship from South Africa, and you are now, you belong to Buputatswana. But Xhosa, which I am, you are now no longer a citizen of South Africa, you are a citizen of, but we, the Xhosas, were very fortunate because we were given two homelands. So if you are a Xhosa, you either belong to Ciskei or to Transkei. Now, this Minister of Justice had been a Minister of Justice in the homeland of Transkei. These were sham states. Some of them, some of these homelands eventually became independent. Initially, they would start off as self-governing territories, and then they would graduate to independence. So I think about four of them became independent states. But as I say, all of that was a sham. They were still part and parcel of South Africa. They answered to the Pretoria government, the South African white government in Pretoria. But going back to this professor, I will not mention his name. You can understand from the fact that he had been a Minister of Justice in the Transkei homeland what kind of person he was. So he took me for constitutional law, and he would teach us about the Transkei constitution, teach us about the 1961 constitution of South Africa, the amendment to that of 1983. Was it the 83 one that introduced the tricameral parliament? The tricameral system being, you know, at least our parliament used to be white only. But in 1983, there was a very great improvement. Indians. Indians were brought in, and colors, so-called colors, were also brought in. To South Africa, race was crucial. That amongst, or rather in progressive circles, we never used to distinguish between Indians, coloreds, and black Africans. Progressive people in South Africa, in a politically correct sense, would lump all of those groups as blacks. But this tricameral parliament split us, Indians, so-called coloreds, and whites, all of them now in parliament. But poor us blacks were still left out. So, but the point I'm making is, this professor would teach us about those sort of constitutions, what each one of them provided, what it meant, and so on. I remember quite distinctly, and quite early on, I used to question him quite a lot. And I could, initially, he would respond quite enthusiastically, but with time, I could tell that he was getting annoyed with me. And I eventually stopped asking him any questions. But fortunately, that year, the University of Transkei, I had already graduated and gotten my first degree. The University of Transkei, you know, there were riots, and never wrote that year. In fact, the riots started around April. Throughout the entire year, the academic year came to a complete end. So we did. Then the following year, and I think it was a blessing in disguise, I went to Rhodes University, where I did my LLB degree. So an interest in human rights had been ignited within me, I would say sort of spontaneously. But when I got to Rhodes University, I was taken by Miss Sarah Christie. I've lost all contact with her, and I think I would really love to make contact with her. She doesn't know about this, but if some of my colleagues have contact with her, I would be pleased if you could actually share the story with her. If there was already an interest, just a little spark, she actually ignited it. in me. She didn't take me for constitutional law. She took me for administrative law. But what is important about that is that in South Africa, the legal fights against the apartheid system were more in criminal law and administrative law. Administrative law, there will be challenges against detentions. Just one example. And criminal law, you can imagine terrorism trials and treason, all of those. That's where the fights would be. Now, Sarah Christie taking me for in administrative law, she just, the subject or the course just came alive. And it was so relevant, the way she presented it, it was so relevant to what was happening in South Africa at the time. I even remember one day, she told us that the following day there was a court in the High Court in Grahamstown where Ismail Mahomed was to appear for one of the cabinet ministers today, Mr. Gugile Nkwindi, who is a national minister in the Democratic South Africa now. He was a detainee and had been in detention for close to a year, I think, and Ismail Mahomed was appearing for him, fighting for his release. And Gugile Nkwindi was also a student at Rhodes, actually, and had basically missed the academic year. So Sarah said, I'm taking the entire class there tomorrow. And I think I should emphasize this. Ismail Mahomed was one of the leading human rights lawyers in the country. He became the first Chief Justice of Namibia whilst being a legal practitioner in South Africa. But he was appointed, when Namibia became independent, they appointed him as their first Chief Justice. And he later became South Africa's Chief Justice. Cutting that long story short, so with that interest, I was very much interested in human rights. And a little piece of paper was put up on the wall the year after I had left Rhodes University. A friend of mine brought it to my attention. I applied, got interviewed by Professor... No. I was interviewed by Professor John Dugard and Professor Carol Lewis, who is now a judge here for the scholarship. Thereafter, I was involved in legal practice, and in so far as, of course, with me, it has not really been international human rights. It's more been within the country, and I did quite a few cases. Then I became senior counsel, and then.
So when he says he's not using international human rights,
I'm getting
to that.
No. I think that was still more in the context in the practice. Yes. No. The court, we definitely. But Section 39(2) of our constitution says the courts, not just our court, courts must, that's obligatory, courts must consider international law and may consider foreign law. But then, of course, it doesn't mean that because it's obligatory that we should consider that we are then bound. We may look and then decide what to do with it, and we do it fairly regularly. And some cases, in fact, actually turn on or about a recent example, which I think was a case we decided, about a judgment written by Justice Majid, who was acting on our court, he's part of the Supreme Court of Appeal, related to crimes, international crimes committed in Zimbabwe by the Zimbabwean police, and let me say allegedly, because nobody has been convicted thus far. The police and military in Zimbabwe. Obviously, nobody would investigate that in Zimbabwe. So some non-governmental organizations came to South Africa. One is Zimbabwean, based in Zimbabwe. The other is international. And they requested the South African police to investigate. And the South African police said, we are not doing that. South Africa has a good relationship with Zimbabwe. So you could expect the politicians. Litigation was commenced. These organizations seeking that government be forced to and the litigation went all the way up, and we as the Constitutional Court directed that must investigate. But that one was about international law all the way through.
By issuing some of the decisions you're issuing.
And what I might also perhaps mention, and which I think is of importance, is that our court is quoted, or rather its jurisprudence is relied on widely, internationally. We were in France in January this year at the European Court of Human Rights, and our colleagues there told us the extent to which they rely on our cases to decide theirs. And to demonstrate to us that they were not just saying this to make us feel good, they had a long list of their judgments on which they relied on a long list of our judgments. So, you know, concrete proof.
I think things were a lot simpler under the apartheid era, as I think if you were, an activist, and or if you were somebody who believed in human rights, or who was somebody who was against the apartheid system, you knew who the enemy was. Put it that way. We knew we had an undemocratic state which was guilty of heinous crimes. In fact, one of the we're South Africa is famous for many things, but we helped to create the whole idea of a crime against humanity. Apartheid was one of the first crimes against humanity that were prepared. So I think it was simpler in a way as a progressive lawyer under the apartheid system, because you knew who the enemy was and you knew what your moral obligation was. We then went through, I think, a little bit of a honeymoon period and a state of euphoria during the early 90s after, the adoption of our new constitution, which I think is an incredibly sophisticated and beautiful document. And things have, I think, like they always do, are I think a little bit more complicated in the current dispensation, because we now have a Liberation Party which is as well entrenched in power as a government. And at the end of the day, sometimes the identity between party and state become a little bit blurred, and sometimes the identity, or there's a divergence between the interests of the government and the people. I think our responsibility as lawyers is to always represent the people, and I think there are some people who are the voice of the government, and like anybody, I suppose, as a lawyer, you do the best job that you can as a lawyer representing the interests of your clients within the bounds of morality, and within, you're always an officer of the court. But I do think there's a new locus of struggle that I think Vinod has mentioned, and I think more and more there's an important role for human rights lawyers to be pushing the boundaries against a state which is not necessarily, I think, always representing the interests of the people now. And so I think we're always we have an obligation as lawyers to be protecting the interests of the people.
For somebody like me, who used mainly to appear for the, in fact, it's not even mainly, exclusively, I appeared for the individual prior to attainment of freedom. Now, post April 1994. We started getting work from the government, the Democratic government. I must tell you that I always found it very difficult to act for government because most of it, my mind, you know, I was just used to acting for the individual. And to, you know, just switch roles like that, it became very difficult. But with time, yeah, I got used to it. But what I should emphasize is that I continued appearing for individuals as well. So, you know, it just became...